My teacher used to say I should make better grades because I had a good imagination and was a creative thinker. That was their teacher way of saying I was a daydreamer. So anyway, I have to ask you one more question about the A-bomb. You were here during the war. Why didn't you just help us blow up the stupid Germans and those cutthroat Japs? Listen to yourself, Greeley. Why should we take sides on something that is none of our business? As far as we are concerned, you are a race of people together. It is up to all of you on this planet to discover that the most important task you face is learning to understand each other. Learn to trust and not be selfish. Over the ages, of course, some of you have learned. But until most of you practice these traits as a daily habit, the world will always be in danger, even more so now that there are planet-threatening weapons. You blow up your home or make it non-inhabitable, and your race is gone. Extinct. Do you understand the seriousness of the situation? But I thought you said the danger from the bombs and the atmosphere is over, Rudy suggested. The danger is in the instability of your nations, the inability to share resources, and trading these resources as instruments of power among the powerful. This can be traced to the lack of spiritual depth of your people, of just not giving our Creator the respect that is due. You might say the unwillingness to temper your most important gift, the gift of independent will. The two are interrelated. You might call it stubbornness. Rudy said, I can vouch for that. My dad is the stubbornest man on the face of the earth. And there is another young man on the other side of this planet who will swear the same thing. It is not a strength, Muhai cautioned. Rudy nodded, trying to comprehend. Tell me again how you're trying to help. Listen to this carefully. The elders who direct my duties do so from outside time and space. They can judge the movement of principles and have the advantage of bolstering certain causes. Theirs is a difficult task, for they must make aesthetic and value judgments that can be determined and molded by subtle manipulations in the timeline continuum. In other words, they can observe the currents of civilizations and suggest different outcomes that will contribute to the overall emergence of good in the cosmos. Do you follow? Of course, there are an infinite number of variations that go forward from any moment in time, but those belonging to one variation continue the identity of their variation. This, in your language, is called string theory. Your physicists are discovering this now, but they have many things yet to uncover in this area. It is enough for you to know that you belong to this variation, and all your decisions and exercises of will continue on this line. But I digress. Rudy was itching to ask a question. Do you mean you time travel? Some can, some do not. But our directors have the advantage of making changes that occur earlier in the timeline in order to affect the direction that a civilization will take. That sounds like gods directing puppets, Rudy said. I don't care much for the idea. Not really. We are bound by a very strict set of principles that can still result in an infinite number of outcomes. Your butterfly wing theory. It is true, you know. Yet there is, as always, the overarching will of the Creator, who is still in charge of all this. You will have to trust that the wills of the directors are at one with the one will. Otherwise, they would not have reached a level of authority. So, you just let Earth develop naturally and humans for eons with no help? Right. Well, maybe one thing. What?
Bees.
What? Bees. They're Sartarian. Most of the food on your planet would not exist without them. We gave you bees. They can't really fly in Earth's atmosphere, except that they have a little, you might say, magic. But that's for another time. He grinned, a Sartarian kind of grin, lopsided. He hadn't quite perfected that. To give your agriculture a little boost, and the subsequent nutrition that goes with it. Superlatively helpful. Rudy considered this. Bees, the real aliens. Okay, I can believe that. He suddenly felt tired, exhausted. "We really do have your best interests at heart, and we really don't intercede unless it is asked for, and unless it is in accord with the will to good." Rudy needed a rest.
"Sounds like what my Sunday school teacher calls prayer. Anyway, I'll take your word for it."
Muhai fiddled with his screen, typed in some characters, then turned to Rudy again, who was now fighting to keep awake.
"I should tell you this one thing to finish. In 1944, we made a timeline modification that we knew would result in the loss of the ship and loss of life. This one brother," he nodded toward the recovering brother, "is the only survivor from the storm crash. We decided that Earth would be better off if the atomic bomb was kept from the Germans, resulting in the demise of the Nazi forces, and the Allies were allowed the development of the bomb, which resulted in victory over the Japanese."
Muhai let this sink in. "Now, understand, Rudy, no one country on this planet is any more moral or deserving than any other as far as we are concerned. The people of Germany were led by a lunatic, an individual who acquired tremendous power because no one stood up for the principle of good. Actually, the Third Reich fell sooner because of another man's compassion for an innocent child that started to ripple toward the end of European conflict in 1944. The child was our agent. I'll tell you the story another time. It's not in the history books."
Rudy looked at him, eyes wide.
"Who are your other agents?"
The Sartarian paused, considered. "There are indeed two other stories involving agents. Besides the child, a woman, a dog, and a Native American.
Oh, they are good stories."
Muhai nodded his head, affirming.
"Great. I finally have a new friend. An alien from another planet,"
Rudy was thinking, and he didn't care if his mind was being read.
"What kind of a connection is this with you, you otherworldly, multi-brained person alien? I need to find out more about you, and how you know things about me.
What I wouldn't give for a little more time on board. I could listen to you all night, but I want to ask you just one more question for now. Am I going to be in trouble back at the base?"
"We will fix that, and you will have no memory of these things I've spoken of."
"Boy, I could be the biggest name in the news for at least—"
"Rudy!" Muhai barked. "Think of others first. Feed on the good decisions and intentions of thousands of your kind. Knowledge is power. The people of Earth are not ready for these things. They cannot be trusted yet. That is why we must erase your memory."
Rudy recoiled, hurt, and was duly repentant.
"Sorry, I've just never ever been important to anybody. Except my mother."
Muhai looked at him, sympathetic.
"I can tell you this, Rudy. What you have gained here this night will give you a new importance, and your life will be changed forever. Your mother will no longer be the only one who values you. I can tell you that."
"You know that?"
Rudy cheered up.
"So, how do you read my mind? The guys on the base at least had to tap my phone."
"That's just what I did."
"You tap my phone?" Rudy asked.
Suddenly, the viewing screen above them lit up like the finale of a 4th of July fireworks display, and multiple explosions went off very close. The ship rocked while it adjusted for the G-forces.
"What is it?" Rudy shouted above the din. "Our cloaking device must have been damaged or turned off, and all hell just broke loose. Your base is firing at us."
Muhai dived for the controls, hands turning into tentacles before Rudy's very eyes.